Since the coronavirus closed schools nationwide, children are staying at home. And coincidentally, during this two-month period, reports to authorities of child abuse and neglect have declined dramatically. As William Brangham tells us, advocates for child welfare are especially concerned about what this says about their safety. Before we continue, a warning. This segment is focused on a sensitive subject, and if there are younger viewers with you, you may want to take a moment to pause or opt out.
That's right, Judy. In normal times, it is difficult to cover child welfare and allegations of child abuse. Now, with a pandemic, it is even more difficult. We wanted to begin by sharing some of the stories and concerns that we heard from many people who are working to try to prevent that abuse. Here's some of what we heard.
My name is Kelly White. I'm the co-CEO at the Safe Alliance in Austin, Texas. We work across the issues of child abuse, sex trafficking, sexual assault, domestic violence. We are particularly concerned because if children are at risk in a home, nobody is seeing them now.
Hi, I'm Georgia Booth, and I am in New York City with the Children's Aid Society. One of our biggest concerns during this pandemic is the safety and well-being of children. We rely heavily on schools and physicians and other adults that are coming in contact with children on a regular basis to report incidences of child abuse and neglect.
Hi, this is Jim Dudley. I am in Redwood City, California, and currently I'm a lecturer on faculty at San Francisco State University. When I was with the police department, I was the captain of our child abuse prevention and investigation group. In COVID-19 days, we don't get those reports, so it's up to the officers to be aware without those other sort of subtle hints that a child may be being abused.
I'm Leah Fraley. I'm the executive director of Stop Child Abuse Now of Northern Virginia. Reports are going down, which makes sense, right? There's less reports because the front line of child protection really isn't in that child's life anymore. Reports are going down. That doesn't mean abuse is going down, right? Just the reports. We are seeing minors making those reports, which is not typical.
I am Dr. Don Plumley. I am in Orlando, Florida, and I'm the medical director at Orlando Health Arnold Palmer Children's Hospital. What we've seen during the pandemic, unfortunately, is we've seen a major increase of children presenting with major injuries. There's children coming with broken bones, head injuries, burns, and we've probably seen an increase of at least 50% to 100% in these cases in the last 2 months.
I'm Xanthi Sharp. I live in Washington, D.C., and I'm the CEO and co-founder of the Fuller Project. The Fuller Project is a global nonprofit newsroom that's dedicated to reporting on the issues that most impact women. During coronavirus, there's been a spike of 230% in the material online, which is child sexual abuse, which is being shared. And that's material that is on the publicly accessible web.
We had a call from a child protective services worker because of a young woman that had been in our teen parent program that's a part of our children's shelter and had left to go back to with her child to go back to her family. And now her someone from her family that had been sexually aggressive toward her was now sexually abusing her child. We got them into our family shelter in a second.
There has been a breakdown as far as the actors that are monitoring and taking down this child sexually abusive material online. We have found through our reporting that the instances of material being taken down has been reduced by 89%.
In our two-county area, Orange County and Seminole County, Florida, we'll see 8 or 9 patients a month. In the last 2 months of March and April, we've seen 19 and 15 children that required hospitalizations.
For a family who, prior to the pandemic, was in that situation, stressed out, overwhelmed, worried about, etc., all of the things that really do lend to difficult environments, that's now worse, significantly worse.
So now to understand a bit more about those concerns, I'm joined now by Dr. Robert Sege. He's a pediatrician at the Tufts Medical Center who works to combat these problems. He's also a senior fellow at Tufts Center for the Study of Social Policy. Dr. Sege, thank you very much for being here. We heard some obviously very alarming reports of injuries going up, of sexual abuse online going up. What in the midst of this pandemic concerns you the most?
I think what I'm concerned about is we really don't know what's going on, that our state and most states around the country have seen a dramatic decline in child abuse reports. We know that some of the risk factors for child abuse are increased. Families are under more stress, more financial stress. Their children are home when they should be in school, and their parents could be employed in essential businesses. They could be unemployed, or they could be trying to work from home. All of those things tend to increase family stress. And one thing we know about child abuse is most people who abuse their children are kind of at the end of the rope. There aren't that many people who are really bad and wake up in the morning and say, I want to abuse or neglect my child. It's mostly good parents who just lose it.
So what we would expect in a pandemic like this, with people being cooped up for this amount of time, this in some ways is, maybe inevitable is not the right word, but this is a not unexpected event.
No, we saw in past natural disasters, there's been an increase in serious child abuse. During the Great Recession, there was an increase in the most serious kind of child abuse, the abusive head trauma for infants. So we're very worried. But this has never happened before. We're really concerned about what we don't see, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it's terrible for every child. And we're concerned that as we slowly begin to reemerge when it's safe to do so, these children have a place to go, people to talk to, and ways to talk about their experience, particularly if they've been abused or neglected in some way.
I'm just so struck by this idea that when there's a decline in reports of abuse, that sets off alarm bells for people like yourself.
Yeah, the thing about child abuse is most child abuse is not reported. And we know that in all times. And that's done because if you ask adults, in many different ways, were you abused as a child? The numbers are much higher than the number of reports. So in all times, and now, the people who report child abuse are their teachers, their early childhood educators, sometimes their neighbors. The children may confide in someone like a grandparent or a beloved aunt or uncle, and those things end up becoming reports into the child welfare system. And of course, physicians, when we see children, if they have bruises that you can't explain or injuries, or or they appear to be neglected, we're also required by law to report. So all of those safety nets built around children just aren't there right now.
Do you have any advice for parents? I hear what you're saying, that this isn't a chronic condition for the most part. People aren't inherently abusive to their children. It's often a situational stress that sets it off. Let's say there are parents that are watching this who are feeling those feelings, are feeling stressed and anxious and nervous and frightened and angry. Is there any generalized advice you can offer for them?
Yeah, there are a couple of things that we know. The first one is reach out for help. Even though you can't physically join someone on telephone, video, any other way that you can get a chance to vent those feelings and know that you're not unusual. We're all feeling moments of frustration and despair under the circumstances. It's the way it is. Secondly, understand that your children's lives are disrupted also. So if they're misbehaving or they're having problems, take a moment to ask them what's going on and what they miss. Children don't know very much yet. They haven't been around long. And sometimes parents can help with some of the things that they're concerned about. And I think the other piece that I just sort of want to make sure to say is no one's very efficient or productive these days. Take some time, enjoy your children, build a fort, go for a walk, whatever it takes. Just have some fun, because this is really bad. It's really hard. But maybe at the end of the day, we'll be able to look back and say it was a really difficult time, but boy, did we laugh.
This is all very, very important advice to take to heart. Dr. Robert Sege at the Tufts Medical Center, thank you very, very much for your time.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Very important, as we heard. And as we just heard, there are a number of groups and hotlines you can call or find on the web if you know someone in need of help. We will include them on our site tonight. You can start with the Childhelp National Child Abuse Hotline. It can be reached by phone or text at 1-800-4-A-CHILD. Or you can go to childhelp.org/childhelp-hotline.